A few weeks ago, I went to a Robert Cray show, and there's a few things that really stood out to me.
You're very low energy right now. Try it again, this time with a little more excitement.
All right, try it again. A few weeks ago, I saw an amazing Robert Cray show, and there's some spectacular things that really stood out to me.
Terrible.
Come on, man.
Do you remember what this video is for?
It's for YouTube.
And what does YouTube like?
Spectacle.
And what is spectacle short for?
Spectacular.
Good. Now ask yourself, what is spectacular about this story?
I don't know, his musicianship and use of dynamics? The fact that he plays completely clean with no pedals?
You're literally killing me here. I know that this really isn't your thing, but people on YouTube have the attention span of a baby on meth. You need to find a hook, and you need to find it fast. Can you at least talk about his massive pedal board?
He didn't have a pedal board.
Did he cover any Jimi Hendrix?
He plays his own music.
How about fire?
What?
Did he light anything on fire?
Do you even know who Robert Cray is?
What about hot takes?
Hot cakes?
Hot takes. Did he say anything shocking?
No.
Did he make fun of white people playing the blues?
What are you even talking about?
You hired me to boost your YouTube engagement. I'm just trying to do my job.
I just think that people will genuinely be interested in the things that I found remarkable about his show.
Not gonna work.
Well, I'm doing it.
Not with me, you're not.
So you're quitting?
You're quitting.
That doesn't even make sense. Just leave.
You can't fire me because I quit.
A few weeks ago, I did go to a Robert Cray show, and despite not being that familiar with his music, I noticed a few things during the show that I think all guitar players, especially blues guitar players, can learn from, and I'm going to highlight a few of those things today. It turned out that not being familiar with the music as much gave me a chance to listen for other things. And as a musician, I heard him and his band do some things that were pretty incredible, and that's what I want to talk about today. So I'm going to switch over to my view here. I bookmarked a video from a show that he did in Paris, and it's the same year, so I think it's part of the same tour. And so this is a good representation of what I would have seen at our local show. The first thing I want to talk about is that his tone. You can see in the video here, he's got two matchless amps with a Fender Vibro King in the middle. And he plays extremely clean. Now, I knew this about him from other performances, but sometimes when people play live, they tend to crank it up a little bit more. That is not the case. Running full tilt with his guitar volume wide open, his tone is still very, very clean. All right, so I'm going to play a little section here where his tone is kind of maxed out. This is about as dirty as it got, even when he soloed. And this brings several challenges with it, because you have to hit your techniques perfectly in order to get notes to ring out. Okay, that bend right there, listen to that. Things like that, when you don't have a lot of distortion and you have a perfectly clean tone, you got to hit them perfect in order to get them to kind of ring out with any sort of energy. But he has defined his sound as this clean, crystal clear Strat sound with just a little bit of hair when he maxes out the volume and he works with it. There, he did it again. Those transitions between boxes, those are some of the hardest things to do with a perfectly clean tone. Every note is heard clearly. There's nothing to hide behind. And sometimes the way that you can disguise your core tone behind pedals and different effects, the sound of that rig is unmistakable. Okay, so that right there, him coming in singing like that, that's another thing I want to point out, is that Robert Cray is a great blues singer. The thing about blues, because it is kind of easy to get into it from a musical standpoint, lot of people end up singing for themselves instead of finding, you know, there's a difference between somebody who can sing along with a tune and somebody who can add some expressiveness into it and like a real vocalist. Robert Cray is not just a blues singer. He is a real blues vocalist. Now, the next thing I want to talk about is the fact that his band was super tight. And whenever you're watching a band play live, if they're going to be tight, maybe the audience can't tell, but as a musician, I can tell when there's little cues going on between them. And I was shocked at how subtle the cues between Robert and the rest of his band were when there was a big change coming. What is that? Let's hear that again. So, of course, I'm thinking to myself, where's the cue to the band? They didn't even stop on an accent. They stopped on a... They stopped right before an accent would hit. And I think that maybe the tell when he starts doing this. And then he has the little duck right there. We go back. So that's like they stop when he ducks. So I'm sitting here and I'm trying to analyze, oh, how did the band know? Where was the tell? Let me tell you, the people in the crowd ate it up. They absolutely loved it because this is one of the things about musicians that non-musician people kind of romanticize. It's like they're all on the same wavelength. And it's like the VSP. No, it's a lot of practice and it's very good instincts and it's being able to pick up nonverbal cues, just, you know, a glance here, a lift of the headstock. These little things, it's hard work. And you get to a place where it feels like you have ESP, like you can communicate on a different plane. But it was just amazing to see. I have another cue bookmarked here. They completely changed the style, the tempo and everything on a dime. Going along like this. That little slowdown. So they're going from a faster tempo to a slower tempo for the ending of the song. Da, 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 da. Listen for how tightly they hit all those things. So everybody's supposed to be following the drummer, right? When you're changing tempos like that, there's no map for how to get from A to B. And it's such a, you're trying to hit every beat. It's just good musicianship all around. His vocalization, the way he sang, the fact that you could hear him that far away from the mic, it just goes to show you how in tune the crowd was with what they were doing. Answer your phone, babe. Oh, yeah. All right, so another thing that I want to talk about related to his singing is his singing and playing fairly complicated rhythm patterns while he's singing without missing a beat. So I have something bookmarked here. Let's take a look at this. I'm going to use my video zoom feature here, and I want you to look. Okay, right there. I can't even do what he's doing there when I'm not singing. I'd have to study it more closely. But he is not just hitting on the downbeat, which is the easiest thing to do when you're singing. He is sometimes hitting on the downbeat, sometimes he's hitting on the upbeat, and he's accenting. You know, you can see by the way he's holding his pick, he's targeting certain strings while he's playing. And he's using very staccato notes, and he's not palm muted. He doesn't have his palm down like this, which means that muting is all right here in his fretting hand. I'm embarrassing myself here because his rhythm playing is so clean. Oh, and by the way, he's singing over top of all of this. Listen to that walk in. His fretting hand, or his picking hand, is way wide like this. But the rhythm line that he plays there is so clean. I can't overemphasize how difficult it is. Burning up with a fever while he's doing this. Burning up with a fever. I'm not even going to embarrass myself trying. It's remarkable the way that he can play and sing at the same time over a fairly staccato syncopated rhythm like that. All right, let me get to one last thing, and that is his use of dynamics. I've seen a lot of different famous blues, maybe not a lot. I've seen my fair share of famous blues acts, and I have never seen anybody use dynamics. I've never seen anybody use dynamics so much during a single 90-minute set. And by dynamics, I mean going way down soft and coming all the way back up. Some bands that I've seen, famous bands, maybe do it once or twice during a two-hour show. He did it like every other song. And have I ever seen anybody use dynamics as much, I've never seen anybody go as low as he and his band did. To the point where you would have been scared to cough or move your shoe or take a step because the audience was so quiet. Everybody was in tune with what he was doing. Now, obviously, this is a different show in a bigger venue than I was in, but I think you'll get the impression. If you listen here, you'll hear people coughing near the person holding I'm assuming it's a phone. And if you listen to the audio, you can hear the room noise. That's how quiet what they're doing here is. You're not just hearing what's coming through the speakers. At this point, they're so quiet, you're actually hearing some of the volume that's coming from the stage. Right there, you heard somebody cough. Okay, what happened right there was really subtle. most people, when they do dynamics like this, you're expecting them to bring it back up. And there were times when he and his band would be doing a quiet section like this, and I would just be waiting for them to start building it up, and he would just keep going quieter and quieter and quieter till his volume was essentially all the way down. So listen to this right here. Let me zoom in here on his fretting hand. Or his picking hand. Okay. Watch his pinky. Very subtly turning his volume down. Oh, let me zoom out again here so you can see this. It's so subtle what he's doing with the volume control. Gets a little bit softer. Softer still. Finally, and that accent right there, talking about nonverbal cues. All he does is stand up just a little bit. And everybody is in lockstep. So, what I'm trying to get across to you is that if you're like me, if you're typically attracted to guitar playing that's kind of over the top and kind of no holds barred, I understand that Robert Cray might not be exactly in your vein of what typically gets you going. But as a guitar teacher and as a guitar player, I am telling you, there are things that you can learn from him, even if the style of music that he writes and plays isn't in your true groove. The musicianship that was on display, the complete mastery of the song, of the rhythm playing and the singing and the tightness of the band. I wish I could rewatch the show having already thought about what I saw, because I feel like I would get even more out of it the second time. I was just trying to figure out what was going on half the time. It was incredible. And so I recommend that you go see him play if you get the chance, especially having these things in mind. In case you wouldn't know to look for these things, prepare to be amazed. If you're impressed by dynamics, if you're impressed by somebody who manages to solo anything with a purely clean tone, or if you're impressed by a band being able to hit cues without obviously signaling to each other, I think you're going to love the show. I enjoyed myself. I hope you enjoyed this video, and until next time, thanks for watching.